Hey, Steve. Hey, congratulations on this new podcast, Unsolved Mysteries.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me. It's great to talk to you.
So I guess the most common question you'll be asked is, are you even a fan of Unsolved Mysteries? I mean, it's been a while.
It's just a terrible show, and I'm really, every day is a chore going in to record it. No, I truly was. It was one of those like appointment viewings when I was a kid. One of those visceral shows that I remember growing up, getting terrified, laying in bed after the show, going, "What did I just watch? What did I just watch?" But truly a fan. And so when this audition came across my desk, it was like, "Oh, wow, wouldn't that be amazing? Oh, if you're doing a podcast, that's incredible." And so as the weeks went on and it suddenly became clear that I was going to get the job, it was, like a dream come true that you never quite knew that you had that dream to be a part of that, this incredible, iconic show. So yeah, definitely a fan, lifelong fan for sure.
So how does it feel that this show is, it's been 10 years, but this show's been resurrected not as a television format, but as a podcast format?
Right. I mean, they have had the Netflix reboot, which has been very successful, but it was sort of a departure in a way from the original series. There's no host per se, no narrator. But I think we've only had one episode as of our conversation now. We've had one episode out. We have a new one coming out tomorrow. I think it lends itself really well to a podcast format. I mean, at its heart, this show is about storytelling, and there's something about just the audio format and listening to interviews that really, I know for me, as a listener, not, forget that I get to host it, but as a listener, I really get drawn into this. And of course, the team producing this, they've been doing this for a little while. They know what they're doing, so they just craft incredible interviews, and the stories that people that they're able to get out of people are pretty fascinating.
Why do you think a show like this resonates with its fans? I mean, it's been on when it was on as a show, it was on for years, and I'm sure as a podcast, you're gonna get tons of fans.
There definitely has already been sort of this outpouring of people. I think the name speaks for itself, right? I mean, you don't, everybody knows Unsolved Mysteries. I think I have this sort of there's this play called Dying City by Christopher Shin, and the character in it is obsessed with watching Law and Order. And I'm paraphrasing this, but she says, "I have this theory about Law and Order, and that it's that we all want to know that people are gonna think about us and look out for us after we die, or if something happens to us, right?" I think maybe deep down, I could be projecting this, I could be making this up, but I think, beyond sort of the kind of cult fascination with it, and oh, it's this creepy show, and oh, people are true crime obsessed. I think maybe at the end of the day, there's this feeling that what this show does is give people hope that if something terrible were to happen to them, or somebody they love, or even just something strange were to happen, there's a show out there, there are people out there that are looking out for them and that are going to try to help them or try to help their family. And I think maybe deep down, that's why this show is so valuable and so important, because it has that sort of deeper, at least for me. I don't know about anybody else, but at least for me, it sort of has that deeper resonance, which is, I think, is very important and what I love so much about it.
Robert Stack was such a iconic host for all those years. And now you are technically the new host narrator of Unsolved Mysteries. Do you feel pressure to step in those big shoes of his?
I'm gonna Google Robert Stack real quick. I'm not sure who you're talking about. He sounds like a
It wasn't he the
fellow.
host of the
He sounds like an interesting guy. I don't know. No, I mean, that's one of those things, right? When you think of Unsolved Mysteries, obviously throughout its, if you sort of know its history, it's had a few different formats, a few different hosts. I mean, it's always Robert Stack, right? And I knew instantaneously that there was no way I was going to ever replace him, or even stepping into his shoes, I don't think is quite right, because nobody can fill those shoes. Nobody can do what he did. And when I knew that the job was going to be mine, I of course dove in and started watching some old episodes. And then after a few episodes, I stopped watching the episodes, because I said, y buddy, you're never going to be as good as he is. You're never going to be able to do what he did. And I also wanted to sort of make it my own. I don't think people would want to listen to some guy, some kid doing a Robert Stack impression. But I, you know, took from, you know, you sort of take what did he do that made it so impressive, so cathartic, so spooky, so so hopeful. You know, he was all of those things in one. So I hope when people listen to it, they hear somebody that is, you know, paying homage to the history of the show, but is in no way trying to repeat, because, you know, what he did was unrepeatable. But, you know, just trying to make it my own and just try to be simple, try to tell the story. You know, I think Robert Stack he put his stamp on it just by doing what he did. He never, you know, he never had to lay it on thick. So, you know, in our sessions, we just try to tell the story. You know, we try to be a part of the story, move it along, give you the information you need, and let you know how you can help. So that's what I hope. I hope I can come.
Have you hosted a podcast before? Because I know you were, you know, a voice over extraordinaire yourself.
Well, thank you. I'll send you your check for adding that adjective in. You know, I've only hosted one other podcast before, years and years ago, for an incredible organization that I was a part of. It's actually a gospel choir that's made up of Broadway and off-Broadway singers. Called Broadway Inspirational Voices. And I think we did maybe 9 or 10 episodes of it. It was just sort of a small thing. But they're a wonderful group, bivoices.org. If you ever want to check out this incredible, extraordinary, inspiring group. But so that was my only podcast hosting job that I ever had. And so coming to this, you know, it wasn't like they're going to hire you because you have a lot of podcast experience behind the boards or something. It's that hopefully you can tell a story. So, you know, I've been a stage actor and singer for a long, long time and a voice actor for many, many years. So I, you know, at the heart of it, what struck me about, you know, especially when they knowing Unsolved Mysteries as I did, and then when they sent me the scripts, it was like reading those old episodes, you know, and I thought the Unsolved Mysteries just knows how to tell stories. And I just hope that I can show off the different range of topics that we're going to cover. And, you know, I guess I'll let you and I'll let the audience be the judge of that. But yeah.
Well, let me show you how I'm going to have you write the other check is by saying that your voice is magnificent. And I want to say, because we're speaking face to face right now, you don't have a face for podcasts. You're good looking.
There's not enough money in the bank to pay you for that one. Thank you. That's very, very sweet. You know, somebody did say, I saw a comment that said, you got to make this podcast like a video podcast. And I thought, we'll be refunding everyone's money if they want to pay for that, because I got a face for radio. But no, thank you. You know, it's funny, even doing an on-camera thing is I've done so little on-camera stuff in my life. And so I'm very comfortable, very happy behind the microphone. But once you put me in front of the camera, it's always a little funny. But it's very, very sweet of you to say. But
well, you know, a lot of my interviews are on camera, but it's just one of those things where people like to see what they're listening to now these days. And that's going to be a change in the future, maybe, you know, one of these days.
I think so. Yeah. And it's so easy to, you know, with like the old radio hosts, and, you know, you sort of have this voice in your head, right? Sometimes for years without ever knowing what that person might look like. And then it's always, oh, so yeah. So it's, you know, it's, to be a part of this where suddenly you have this built-in fan base, and certainly there are going to be a lot of high expectations. And so I hope people know Robert Stack is in my heart. I won't be able to do Robert Stack and give you Robert Stack, but I hope you, when they hear it, that's, you know, we're hoping to find that same sense of hopefulness and mystery that he brought to everything he did. So,
well, I've listened to your first episode so far, and it was extremely captivating. How many episodes did your producers or actually plan for this season for yourself?
I believe, I could be wrong, but I believe there might be something like 40 episodes planned. So it'll be a really nice run of episodes, and with a wide range of topics. You know, people who know Unsolved Mysteries know that we're going to cover a lot of ground and tell you a lot of different stories. So we started off with a really spooky a paranormal episode about Ball Cemetery, and then tomorrow's episode, next week's episode, is very, very different from that. So I won't spoil anything, but you'll just have to tune in to find out. So, yeah, 40 episodes, I think, for season number one. And I hope people enjoy them.
That's a lot of episodes, I do have to admit. Are they all pre-recorded for you already, or do you actually go week by week?
They're sort of going as they go along, you know, compiling the interviews, and then Cadence 13 is putting them all together. So I typically get a rough scratch track of the whole episode, just so I know, you know, the feel of the episode and what we're talking about. And then we record my stuff, and they add that back in. We're sort of, you know, I guess we're doing this every other week. We do a couple episodes a session, and we'll be working on this throughout the year, but we've already got a lot in the can, as they say, and they'll be rolling out. And, you know, it's one of those things, I think, when you do a podcast, people are hungry for it. You know, as a really avid podcast listener, I know that I want that podcast to show up every week, you know, whatever the day is. It's something you sort of, you know, you can mark your schedule by. So we gotta give the people what they want. So hopefully throughout most of the rest of the year, you'll have Unsolved Mysteries to listen to and keep you company.
You know, as someone who gets to read everything for every episode, like yourself, do you ever have the urge to investigate something yourself? Maybe like to go to that cemetery you just talked about in the first episode?
I would never go to Ball Cemetery because I'm too scared a person. Are you nuts? Why would I go to that place? These stories are really captivating, and I especially find that the ones that really hit me are like the stories about abducted children or missing children. As a father myself, those really hit home in sort of a very serious way. And so I find that I do want to help somehow. And I've been thinking as this has been going along, how can I do that? And it's amazing, right? These cold cases, they require somebody somewhere to take an interest, to keep that flame burning, to say, I'm going to help this family. I'm going to help these people some way, even if it's just, I'm going to try to put the memory of this person to rest in a way that they haven't been able to, you know, find some peace for the memory of this person. It definitely has sort of brought out sort of the true crime side of me and the interest in that. So it's a good question. I'm sort of mulling over what's the best way to facilitate that in the future. But absolutely, each of these stories gets me in one way or another. And, you know, I definitely, you know, want to be a part of that.
And for you, Steve, what's the enjoyment of, you know, playing into your strength of your voice, you know, as a career?
That's a very good question. I mean, I do feel like I'm the luckiest guy in the world, right? It was very sweet that, like, for years people said, oh, you have this interesting voice. Have you ever thought about doing voiceovers? And I always thought voiceovers was kind of a side career that, oh, you could do a commercial every once in a while and supplement your income. But deep down, I grew up, you know, my father was a fantastic storyteller, and I just fell in love with stories and with engaging people. So the idea that somebody, especially, you know, Unsolved Mysteries has reached out to say, we would like your voice to tell our stories for us, is, it's very moving. It's really a special thing for me. So I feel, you know, that I am now a part of this thing. So when you're listening to the stories, it's me, you know, it's not just a job. It's not just, oh, I get to, you know, I narrate this kind of creepy show. It's, no, I'm giving of myself. You know, when you use your voice, this is a part of yourself that you give to everything. And I try to give that to every project that I do, no matter if it's Unsolved Mysteries or any of the other things that I'm lucky enough to do. So, but getting to work from home, even long before the pandemic, I'm talking to you from my little home studio. And so that idea is pretty amazing that I get to step in this booth and talk to people all over the world and record stuff. So I thank my lucky stars every day.
I was gonna ask, is that, You have your own home studio. Are you doing this podcast from home? Never stepped into a studio or nothing like that, huh?
No, I mean I've been working from home for years, and I would occasionally go into the city depending on what I was doing. But you know, ever since this started, I've been working exclusively from my home studio for almost the last year. So yeah, Unsolved Mysteries is entirely done from right where I'm sitting right now, and we'll continue to do it from there. So every episode you'll hear this familiar reverberation of this booth, and that's where it's done. That's how we do it these days. The technology is amazing that allows voice actors to kind of get everything done from home these days. If you can make it work.
Wow. So you made quarantine cool before quarantine.
I don't think I make anything cool, but I've been quarantining for a very long time. Yes, let's just say that.
Yeah. Excellent, Steve. Well, let us leave with one more thought, because obviously you and I are speaking virtually from one coast to another coast here. Besides the voice stuff, how are you staying sane and creative during this entire time?
Boy, I wish I could say with full assurance that I was. No, I think there is something about routines, right, that sort of help you do this. I mean, I have my almost 6-year-old son that we're sort of facilitating his virtual schooling every day. My wife is working from home. It's funny that you say besides the voice stuff. I mean, honestly, I've been very, very lucky. It's an overused thing, but I've been very blessed to have work throughout this pandemic. You know, so many people haven't had work. And so the work is, especially having Unsolved Mysteries every other week to kind of regiment me. But also I think, we're lucky to live near some nature. We get outside, we take nature walks. We just sort of stop for a little bit and look at the sky and remember that, that the world is an awfully big place and there's a lot of things we don't understand. And I think just trying to like get out of the confines of our house when we can, when we're able. And other than that, my family, we're just trying to help each other out. And I think it's fascinating, my wife and my son and I, we've developed this very unspoken, habitual lifestyle where we kind of know what we're doing every day and when somebody needs some time to themselves. And so I think it's a lot of cooperation that sort of helped keep us sane. How about you? What are you doing out there? Are you able to move around and get out every once in a while? Or,
well, I'm in a little bit more conservative country, so a lot more is actually opened in its own case. But just like you, I get to talk to you, everybody else, Zoom calls. I do four or five a day. All day. I think as of today, I already hit about 140 people since the first. Wow. So
amazing.
I know, and I'm not even a podcast.
I'd say you're doing all right for yourself. I definitely haven't talked to 140 people since this whole thing began. But no, it's a great point. I mean, anytime that, and I don't do it nearly enough, but anytime that I can get together with some old pals on Zoom or something and just say hi, just see some faces. And we've had birthday parties. My son's about to have his second quarantine birthday party, some old Zoom with family. But even that, as frustrating as it is, as hard as it is, we're all in this together, right? And so being able to share just even just a little virtual space is really nice. So
absolutely. Well, hey Steve, thank you for this conversation. Really appreciate putting the face to the voice that a lot of people would be curious about. So, and once again, congratulations to Unsolved Mysteries.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having us on. And thanks for being a supporter of our show. We hope you guys enjoy it.
Excellent. Next time, Steve.
Thanks, Keith.